Hi everyone, welcome to the Chrissy B Show, and I hope you know by now that we are the UK's only TV program that's dedicated to your mental health, well-being and success. Now that last topic is a big one, and you don't get much more successful than my guest tonight. We welcome Mark Wright, winner of The Apprentice and founder of digital marketing agency Climb Online, as the new resident business expert on the Chrissy B Show. Today we'll be getting to know the real Mark. What was he like growing up? What were his first ambitions before he became one of Europe's top 30 under 30 marketing and media masters? Then we'll also be hearing Mark's 7 top tips on formulating a winning business idea and, of course, how to look after your mental health whilst doing so. With this in mind, we'll be hearing from our fitness expert Benjamin Cooper, who'll be showing us how we can fit simple but effective exercises into our daily routine. And if that's not enough, we also have some suggestions from the public on how to make an extra £100 in a week. And we also have Helena Chard on to give us all the celebrity news in this week's Behind the Fame, as well as Dr. Rob Hicks, who will be answering all of your medical questions in Doctor's Answers. Now in 2015, there were 5.4 million private sector businesses here in the UK, 3% more than in 2014. Of all the businesses in the UK, 99.9% are SME, that is small or medium sized. What's more, there is a sharp rise in entrepreneurs between the ages of 20 and 29 starting their own businesses, more so than in any other age group. A third of UK businesses are based in London or the South East, and 20% of small or medium sized businesses were majority led by women. Here in the UK, we are ranked number 6 of 189 in the world for ease of doing business. And the internet is estimated to represent a £19 billion business opportunity for small firms in the UK. So clearly, business is booming, but it's not all plain sailing. Let's hear what some of you have to say. Nicole shares her struggles. She says, starting a business is a stress like no other. Having someone second guess your every move is the reason I consume wine in large quantities. Brittany says, the process of starting a business has been stress, but I can't wait to share it with everyone. Vince says, can we talk about the stress that comes with starting and running a business? Yes, we can, Vince. John Lobo says, starting up a business is veritably full of struggle and stress. It requires consistency, perseverance, patience, and endurance. Melissa tells us how she copes, starting a business that consists of just a room full of sofas and snuggly cats for stress relief. Chief Servant says, nothing prepares you for the mental stress that comes with starting up a business. It takes a lot to keep sane in difficult times. So clearly there's no shortage of businesses and new starters here in the UK. But if the pressure was on for you to make some quick money, how would you go about it? Well, we took to the streets of London to find out from you guys.
For a while now, our financial climate has not been good, and as we know, therefore, money's been tight. Now, if someone was to come up and ask you to make £100 in addition to your normal salary, how would you make it and fast?
Does going to the bank of dad count?
I'd probably buy loads of cheap stuff and sell them a bit at a higher price to make a bit more profit.
I'd find some of my old things that are still looking really good and start selling them off to make some money. Or I make some ice lolly and sell them out.
Or who would you sell the ice lollies?
Oh, children, of course. I'll go around the streets and say, hey, this is really sweet, new flavor, and see what happens.
Cool. Sell paintings, play guitar on the street. I don't know.
Do you play the guitar?
Yeah.
Well, considering we're hairdressers, probably do private haircuts and make money out of that way. So get like all the clients that we do, charge them say £40 each. That way you've got two clients, you've already got £80, so you do another one, 120
quid. I'm a swimming teacher, so I'd probably hire a pool and do some swimming lessons.
I'd like to go and help kids teach, you know, by teaching or doing something along those lines, yeah.
So what would you do, just charge for like individuals into tuition classes?
I'd probably just cover costs, like work for a full week and just say, hey, $100, that'll do.
Probably find some sort of investment that I could put it into just to get the money back quite quickly.
Probably sell half my DVD collection just to make some money. That would probably cover the £100.
How would you do it? Where would you sell?
I'd have to become savvy with something like eBay and just sell it on there. There's no other, otherwise it'd just be a hassle, wouldn't it?
So thank you very much to the public for their suggestions there. So now it's time to head over to Helena Chard for this week's Behind the Fame. Welcome to the show, Helena.
Hello, Chrissy.
How are you?
Lovely. Feeling good. Yes. Lovely smell of cinnamon.
We have this week a selection of delicious sweet pastries and buns from Fabrique in Hoxton, East London. So thank you very much to Fabrique. Actually, I have had one already. I'm sorry, Helena, I had one before you.
You're allowed to.
It was amazing.
Busy schedule.
Thank you very much.
And you can take one home.
Yes, I will take one.
Be nice.
So what do you have in store for us today?
So just beginning with, you know, we're always hearing such bad things reported in the media. Yes. So it's always good to talk about some positive things. Mm. With a little twist, because there's an unfortunate situation that led to it. But I call it the chain of love. And the other day on Waterloo Bridge, unfortunately, two tourists were involved in a motorcycle accident. Mm-hmm. But it was the whole way that everybody just, you know, rallied together. Mm. People sort of cordoned off each end, and they used their phones by way, because it was quite dark, to stop cars coming on. Okay. There was an out-of-hours doctor who was wandering around and who managed to resuscitate the gentleman, which was great. Siobhan Daly, who's a film producer, was just walking over the bridge at the time and rushed over and was talking to them to keep them, you know, to keep them engaged. And just, it's just amazing how everybody, I mean, the off-duty doctor was calm, and it was just the way everybody just rallied together, which is just a really special.
That's cool, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think Siobhan Daly was just, it suddenly made her realise how fabulous London is. Yeah,
it's so true.
Just a
people
simple story.
People do rally together when there's something going on, they do, like,
they definitely
come together
do.
And help.
So it's just, it made me smile, so that was very lovely. Also, Chrissy Teigen, who's a model and married to the lovely John Legend, she gave birth to her little baby Luna, who's 11 months now. But she developed postpartum depression, and she's still suffering with it. But she's opened up and she's talking about it now, really, just because she couldn't believe that she got the condition, because she's got such a fabulous life, you know, nothing to moan about, and she just couldn't believe it. So it was just a way that, obviously, as we know, it doesn't discriminate.
It doesn't,
so she's
really, and it's really nice that she's actually speaking about it, because some people don't even want to, like, tell anyone or what's going on.
Absolutely.
But it's true, you know, sometimes when people feel guilty saying that I have this, I'm depressed because my life's really good, but actually it can hit anyone.
Yeah, and I think one of the things she's saying, you know, not to be ashamed.
Yeah.
So we're really pleased about that. Mm-hmm. Also, Ben Affleck, he's always in the news, divorce and various things, but he's actually talking about his stint in rehab and how thankful he is to his ex, Jennifer Garner, and children. All the family as well rallied around him, and he's really, really thankful. But he actually put it out on Facebook. I'm not too sure about releasing it on Facebook. It's a funny medium, I think, to do it on. But just to say that, you know, he wants to live his life to the fullest, be the best father he can be, and wants his children to know that there's no shame in getting help again. So it's just a nice, simple story, which is great. Something that made me smile, because it's something I like, I don't know whether you do, I'll find out. So if you're sick of Easter eggs, as in cheap Easter eggs, obviously they're in the shops at the moment, a food blogger called Anne M. Hobson, she found a great alternative and has launched the Cheester egg.
Oh.
And the Cheester egg is obviously, it's a solid cheese egg made with huge love, which I think was really nice. And it's made with a collaboration of independent artisan cheese makers. It's Wild's cheese. I love cheese. So for me, I thought,
I like both, so, you know, it's just
good
more temptation around.
I know, cheese and chutney and all delicious things. So they're selling that, so I'm going to go and have a little look.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's a really,
nice,
really
idea.
Nice one. It is, isn't it? Yeah. So we've had International Happy Day, which is good. And interesting to hear that Norway's been named the happiest country in the world.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Norway. And the reason being, it's a report that, in fact, the United Nations report talked about happier countries. They have a healthy balance of prosperity, trust in society, low inequality, and confidence in the government. So really lots of things that maybe we don't have here. Okay. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Possibly.
But so it's quite an interesting one. Another sweet story as well. I changed someone's life today. Now, not necessarily me. I'm talking about Kate Langwens, who's the hairdresser in Wisconsin, in North America, and she had a customer come in and who looked really just not particularly well, and she came in to buy loads and loads of hair products, and she spoke to her and said, you know, what do you want to buy? And she realised that actually the lady was very depressed and she'd not been able to get out of bed for 6 months and her hair had gone into a big sort of mat where she'd just tied it back and just left it. Mm. Anyway, so she said to the lady, look, put that down, come in tomorrow and I'll sort your hair out for you, which was so good. Lovely. But anyway, it was a whole thing. She kept cancelling. She didn't come, she didn't come in. Then one day she just walked in, again, still with the same hair. And she said, right, you're staying here. And she stayed with her in the salon for 8.5 hours.
Oh, wow.
So she combed out her hair and she spent, I think, 3 hours. It spent quite a few hours colouring her hair. It was a very quick cut. But she then released this lovely post on Facebook saying how she enjoyed it and how strong the woman was. And it was just, it's just gone viral. But it's just a lovely, touching story. And also the woman, in fact, joined in as well and was so thankful. It's really just nice, really nice, isn't it?
Just these little things that you do for people. I know it was more than a little thing, but these things that you do for people can make such a difference.
Absolutely, just small things. And just quickly, Sesame Street, that we know, has a long tradition of showing characters with different social personalities so that children teach children about tolerance. Yeah. And there's a new character that's been introduced called Julia, who has autism. She's got like a little orange bob but she's a good singer and she remembers all her songs and loves stargazing and things like that. But it's a great initiative to raise understanding. Yeah. And it's just, you know, to see all the amazing in every child. But I just thought it's very...
And of course we've got Autism Awareness Month April.
So it was poignant, I thought.
Brilliant.
Yeah, so it was lovely.
Time for foodie, I think.
Time for foodie, I think so.
So you've got yours, what's your one?
Mine's cinnamon. Okay. I do love cinnamon.
And these ones are cardamom.
And tea.
And obviously we have our croissants.
You can have tea, Chrissy.
I had the cardamom already and I'm going to try a bit. This is my hubby. I'm going to take some to my hubby. That's the cinnamon one, which I do want to try. Thank you so much and we'll see you again next week.
Of course.
All right, guys, so don't go anywhere because after the break, I'll be getting to know our new resident business expert, Mark Wright. Welcome back to the Chrissy B Show, everybody, your TV programme for all things related to mental health, well-being and success. Now, my next regular needs no introduction, but I'll give him one anyway. He's won The Apprentice, he's the business partner to Lord Sugar, founder of digital marketing agency Climb Online, and now, perhaps most impressively, he's your resident business expert on the Chrissy B Show. He is, of course, Mark Wright. Hello, Mark.
Hey, Chrissy.
Did you like the last bit?
I was going to say, what a recommendation.
That was so cheeky, wasn't it?
I know. If Lord Sugar's picked me and now you, what a success it's been.
So good to have you back on the show. So we have obviously interviewed you before on the programme, but now we did it. You know, we loved your story and how inspiring you are and how successful and how, you know, you're very open to be interviewed and express yourself. We love all that. So that's why I've invited you as a regular on our programme. So before we get into, we are going to have some tips which you'll be giving us later on, seven things to think of when you're starting your business. Mm-hmm. But first, Mark, we'd like to, for the benefit of the viewers that didn't watch the last interview, we'd like to sort of delve into your life a little bit growing up. So where were you born?
A little country town in Australia called Armidale.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's a very, very little town in Australia. So my voice sounds a little bit different to the ones you normally hear. Yeah. And yeah, I grew up in a little town, went to the local school. My mum was the hairdresser in the town. My dad's he owns the local garage. Yeah. And yeah, so I started pretty much in a town where most people go to school. They then go and work in the town, they marry someone from the town, and then I guess you die. And I was reading on Wikipedia the other night that I'm the most notable person to be born in my town.
Oh, so, really? That's good.
It's been a bit of a journey to this point at only 27. But I remember that, you know, when I started at school, I always knew that I would be sat here kind of having achieved quite a lot. Yeah.
Wow. That's really cool.
Yeah,
that's good to know. Because some people, actually, other people that have been on the show always knew from when they were very young that they wanted to do something really big with their lives. That's really good.
Very driven.
Okay. And what was it like sort of at school for you at the time?
I think I look back on school with mixed emotions. Mm-hmm. When I first started school, so in Australia you have two versions of school, junior school, which is 5 years old to 11, and then senior school, which is 11 to 18. Yeah. And in junior school, I really struggled. I have short sight, bad vision, and this wasn't picked up by my teachers until I was about 9 years old. So I missed the first few years of school with missing the fundamentals. I wasn't able to do maths, basic maths or English. and I'm also dyslexic. So coupled those together, I failed junior school pretty drastically. And so as a child, you don't know you're different to the other children. Mm. You just think, I'm just not as good at this as everyone else.
Do you remember how that made you feel at the time?
I just hated school, and I blamed school and the environment for it. I remember, because when you're bad at something, you don't like it, especially when you're a kid, because you don't know and you can't understand why you're not as good as the other kids. I didn't know that I was dyslexic. I didn't know my vision was worse than the people sat next to me. And I just didn't click with school. And kids can be quite cruel as well, because I wasn't at the same level and I was really struggling. I had to have support for reading and writing and things like that by like a learning aid teacher. And you feel really... you don't feel like the other kids. And I think an element of that has really assisted my drive into becoming more successful.
That's quite interesting, because some people would sort of, that experience would kind of like tarnish them for good, and they'll be like, well, I can't amount to anything because I didn't do well at school, so I'm just going to not do anything. But in your case, it kind of drove you the other way.
Yeah, well, I think life is balance, really. And I think where I was underdeveloped in my educational circumstances, I overdeveloped.
Well, you thought you got the support you needed.
Well, there you go. I worked really hard in the latter years to recover a lot of the learning difficulties I had as a child, and now I see myself at no disadvantage. Yeah. I read and write slower than most people, definitely. But I work harder than everyone else, so it puts me on the same level playing field. But school was really, really tough. Mm-hmm. I was a bit of a naughty kid as well, which didn't help. And I think that was also led from the difficulties I was having. I was kind of breaking out, and I didn't want to be there. I wanted to play sport. And then
I was very good at.
I was really good at water skiing and football.
Okay.
And I think just as a child, what's natural is to do what you're good at, and that's all I wanted to do. So I left school. I went through senior school. I didn't do very well, to be completely honest with you. Mm. But I had a passion for making money. Okay. All I wanted to do was be rich and be a businessman. That's what I knew, but I never knew in what business.
Okay. Now, Mark, let's now fast forward to coming to the UK.
Yeah.
What did you do once you arrived here?
So I ran out of money backpacking in Europe, and I needed to come to London. It was the closest town that spoke English. I'd been travelling for almost a year, and I landed in England with £171. So what I had discovered before I left Australia, I helped a chap in a personal training college where I was working as a personal trainer. Mm. I helped him build a website and get it to the top of Google. So I developed a bit of a passion for digital marketing.
Okay.
Got to London, needed a job, needed some money, and I went to work selling digital marketing.
Okay, and then how did you end up on The Apprentice?
Well, very good question. So, wasn't happy with the firm I was working at. Mm. I didn't like the way they treated their customers. I didn't like the way they treated their staff. So I created a business plan for what I believed would be the best digital marketing company. I took it to four banks. They wouldn't even open an account for me because I'm from Australia, not from England. And the guy...
Make a mistake.
Exactly. And the guy that sat next to me at work, he said, listen, I'm going to go and try out for a show called The Apprentice. It's a show where an old man yells at you. Do you want to come along? I was like, sounds horrendous. So I went along with my friend to the tryouts of The Apprentice. 56,000 people tried out on the day I went in for The Apprentice. And I was lucky enough to get from the 56,000 down to the 20 that went on to Series 10. And then I went from the 20 to 1, and I became Lord Sugar's business partner on Series 10.
That's just amazing, considering that you didn't even know about the show when you came here. You'd never heard about Lord Sugar before. And then just to win the show as well.
I think it helped. I think people that go on to the show now, they try and be characters from the other series. They try, they think, such and such was successful, so if I act like them, I'll be successful.
Yeah.
And because I had no preset ideas, I just was myself. I just spoke to Lord Sugar how I'm speaking to you now. I just did the tasks as I would do every day. And I think that's a lesson I always tell it to my staff is, you can't pretend to be anyone else, so you might as well just be the best version of yourself, you'll be successful in business, and I think you'll be pretty successful in life.
Yeah, definitely, I agree with that, Mark. So, what was maybe the toughest part of being on The Apprentice, would you say?
It was dealing with the other so many other personalities. We were locked in a house for 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, no wallet, no phone, no contact to the outside world.
No phone.
Nothing. No internet, no TV. And you could be in there for a day or you could be in there over 12 weeks.
Wow.
So it's dealing with all the personalities. You've got the filming, you've got the candidates, you've got Lord Sugar, you've got a TV production. It is a lot to manage. And it's pretty stressful. It's one of the most stressful things I've ever done in my life.
How did you keep yourself focused and grounded?
I was on the whole time. I would never slip up. So I was the first one to go to bed, and I, like, even to the point where the other contestants would tease me. So 8:30 would come, I'd go straight to bed.
Wow.
I was in bed, first into bed. I was the first one up in the morning.
What time would you get up?
About 4 o'clock in the morning, four thirty in the morning,
okay,
and be ready for the day. Yeah. So I took it more serious than anyone.
Okay.
And the key thing is everything would get fed back to Lord Sugar, what people would say in the house, how they would act, how they would dress, because Lord Sugar's looking for an all-round person, not someone that's good just at business, but that can conduct themselves appropriately and professionally. So I just focused on that.
You're getting some inside information here. That's really
interesting. Yeah, exactly. Well, I think it's important because Lord Sugar wants to work with someone that you know is reliable, that's not going to be at a bar being disgusting or, you know, showing the brand up of the show or himself or themselves. Right. And I kind of clicked on that, you know, you needed to be sensible. And I think that I took it more serious and I wanted it more than anyone else. And again, it comes back to my schooling. Was I the smartest person in my series of The Apprentice? Absolutely not. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. There were some absolute brain boxes in there that were very, very talented people. Mm-hmm. But I wanted the opportunity more. I fought harder than they did. And I won
it. Showed.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So now tell us about Climb Online before we go to break, Mark. How's that going? And, you know, what have been the achievements so far?
It's been the best journey of my life. So we opened Climb Online. I remember the moment I opened the bank account for Climb Online and Lord Sugar had given £250,000 and I WhatsApp photoed it to my dad.
Yeah.
And I said, look, £250,000. And then there was a realization that an investor had given me a lot of money and a pretty crazy investor, so it needed to go right. And we've been trading 2 years. We're one of the most successful businesses to ever come from the Apprentice platform. Paid Lord Sugar back his investment within 9 months. We've got over 40 staff, 3 offices. We're expanding abroad. We open in Manchester next month. We've helped over 450 businesses with their digital marketing in the UK. Mm-hmm. But it's provided a lot of people jobs, a lot of people opportunities, and I have a job that I go in and I love. And it's the first time I've got up ever in my life. I hated school, I didn't like studying, and I worked a lot of jobs I didn't like. And you always hear these people, do what you like, do what you say, what you want to do in life.
Yeah.
It's so true, because now I go and I'm happy every single day. And it took some years to find the right thing, but I found it and I've made more money, had more success and provided success for other people.
I suppose that when you do really love what you're doing, it does kind of counteract the stress that comes along with having a business. But obviously it must get stressful sometimes. How do you deal with that?
To be honest, it's a challenge. Dealing with stress in a business environment is always a challenge, and it can rule you if you don't rule it. So I do things like, I was just saying before, I have an hour a day where I don't use my mobile phone. I've started removing it from the room before I go to bed.
Oh, that's good.
Because I used to wake up in the night and read an email. And if it was, didn't matter if it was good or bad, it would make me stressed.
Yeah.
I now meditate. I meditate for half an hour a day. Mm-hmm. I make sure I go to the gym and run at least 3 times a week for half an hour.
Okay.
I try and be healthy. And I try not to overthink. Overthinking in business is the same as in life, but amplified. You can really concentrate on things that are going to happen in the future and catastrophize them. You could be like, oh, we might not get that deal and I might not be able to pay the wages. I'm stressed. And so it's controlling what you can control, taking time for yourself and looking at things with a positive outlook makes you more successful and more stable.
Yeah. What do your family back home think of all of your success and what you've done?
I don't think they know 100%. I think they think I talk it up, but I'm sure that they're very proud. And one day, my goal has always been to retire my mum and dad so that they never need money again. Oh,
do you keep in touch with them regularly?
All the time. I talk to my mum every day.
Every day.
I WhatsApp her just like I'm living in Australia. But yeah. Family is the most important thing. Your family will never, ever leave you. They will never, ever, you know, care about money or fame or success. They're always stable. They were there at the start. They'll be there at the end. And it's important to look after them because they'll always look after you.
True words, Mark. Well, we're going to keep you on, obviously, because that was just an intro to Mark Wright for everybody at home. But now, after the break, we're going to be hearing some advice, because that's what you're on here for.
I'm ready
business
to do
tips.
It.
Let's and make do sure, it. Guys, you tune in every time Mark is on, because his tips are going to be amazing for you guys who want to start your own business. So don't go away. Hi, I'm Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel, Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back to The Chrissy B Show, everyone, the TV program that looks after your mental health, well-being and success. Now, before the break, we were getting up close and personal with our new business expert, Mark Wright, who'll be now giving us 7 top tips on how to formulate a winning business. Mark?
Yeah.
7 tips for our viewers. They've been so excited about this.
I know. I wish I was charging you for these tips, Chrissy, because they're so good. If you listen and implement them, watch out. Your business will be successful.
Brilliant. We're looking forward to it.
Okay.
So what's the first one?
The first tip for business success is to go into a business that you know about. Mm-hmm. You need to know about what you're going into. The number one failure of any business I've gone in where I've mentored or consulted is they've gone into something because someone else has been successful in it. Mm-hmm. And that's the wrong reason. You need to go into a business or follow an idea that you know about or that you're interested in. That's the first and most important thing.
Okay.
Because like I said with my journey, if I didn't enjoy what I did at the moment, I wouldn't be successful. And I'd worked in the sector before. Investors will always look for a track record in the sector that you're putting forward if you're looking for investment. So that's very important.
Okay.
So tip one, know about what you're going into. Okay, so my second tip would be to have a business plan. Before I did The Apprentice and before I worked with Lord Sugar, I didn't attribute any success to writing a good business plan. One, because I didn't really want to write one.
Mm-hmm.
But through the business coaches and mentors I have and through working with Lord Sugar, I now understand the importance of writing a good business plan and spending time on that, because every business goes through tough times.
Yeah.
But when you do, you can revert back to your plan and it puts you back on the right course.
Okay.
And it's really helped me in business.
Yeah, and you can definitely get the support with that as well. You don't have to try and do that on your own.
I went to the bookshop and bought writing a business plan for dummies and literally wrote a business plan, and I've stuck to it and I've hit every number and objective I set in my plan, because it comes back to setting goals, which is one of my latter tips. But if you have a plan and you stick to it, it's better than not having a plan and being all over the place.
Okay. And your third tip, Mark?
Third tip, well, I've just kind of alluded to it. My third tip is setting goals. I think that is important as a business person and as a business. If you've got strict goals and KPIs that you need to hit as an individual, you've got the aiming point. This is an addition to the business plan, but setting goals for yourself as a business person and for the business will help you get direction and make sure that you know the things you need to improve on and your weak points as well.
Okay. Tip number four.
Tip number four is educating yourself. I always say if you want to earn more, you've got to learn more.
Okay.
Now, coming back to my personal journey, being dyslexic and not liking to read and write, is education. A lot of people, when they finish school in this country, the average person never goes on to read another book again. The average CEO of the Fortune 500 companies in the UK read on average one book a week. So that shows you. Yeah, that shows you. The people at the top of the business ladder are educating themselves on success, on business, and on their sector.
You know what, Mark? Even if you don't support anything else today, just that one point, I think, will just like help so many people's lives already, but obviously you're going to tell us more. But that's amazing.
Yeah.
That's so good to know.
I know.
Can you read more?
I know. Well, when I read this, I was like, this is bad news I hate reading. I read the page of a book. I get to the bottom. I can't remember what I just read. So I thought, what am I going to do? So I started listening to audiobooks. Each week I'd download one audiobook, and that can be about business, digital marketing, general success. And since I've done that, I've nearly tripled my income every year.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Wow. Guys. Priceless things you're getting on the show today. Brilliant. Okay.
Exactly.
Now I forgot what tip we're on. Number four.
Number five.
Number four or number five?
Tip number one, get it in a business idea you like. Write a business plan. Goals. Learn more if you want to earn more. We're up to tip number five.
Tip number five. Thank you, Michael.
I'm organized.
Yeah. I got all excited about the last tip.
Okay. So tip number five. for me, is investing in the right people. Chrissy, when I started my first business, I got the wrong people. What I wanted to do was save money. Every business owner gets so concerned with saving money, and the saying is, if you pay peanuts, you get monkeys. You need to invest in the right people.
Yeah.
And having one or two key members of staff in your organization can really drive it forward. Don't cut costs and get bad people. Get people that have experience again in your sector. They want to work hard for you in your business, and that you have a good relationship with, because it can make a big difference. If you get the wrong people in, they can poison the company. You get the right people in, they can drive you forward. The key thing that I do in my businesses is give people equity or give them profit shares in the company. I don't mind sharing the success. Mm-hmm. A lot of business owners are so focused on getting all the money for themselves and all of the success for themselves that they forget to build up other people.
Mm-hmm.
Your staff's success is your success. A lot of my staff have gone on to be just as important in the digital marketing industry as I have, but that's making my company more successful.
Yeah.
And that's been a real key learn for me. Focus on helping others, and they will help you much more in return.
Do you think some companies maybe don't do that because they're kind of afraid, like, okay, I'm investing in this person, I'm training them, and they're just going to go and be my competitor later on?
Exactly. Yeah. Most people are so scared that they're going to train people up and they'll leave to become a competitor.
Mm-hmm.
But a famous saying is by Steve Jobs that said, if you focus on, if you're worried that your staff are going to be overtrained and leave you and be a competitor, you should be more worried they'll be undertrained and stay in your organization. And it's so true. You would rather overtrain them and the possibility they might go, so what, you've helped someone go on a great journey for themselves. I'd rather that not undertrain them and them stay and treat my customers poorly and with bad service.
Definitely. Next tip, Mark.
So tip number six we're on to now is we need adequate financing for a business. A lot of businesses, we live in the world of the bedroom DJs, people working from home, and those businesses are great and we're seeing a great boom, but you need money to run your business. A lot of people don't have any money, and that's where they fail. By putting together a good business plan and a good strategy, you can get financing for a business.
Okay.
The key thing to growing your business is having good equipment, good staff, and facilities. That's what's really going to help you invest in the technology in your product and get the right people and surroundings to make your business grow. This was a thing, again, for me, I really didn't, when I started out, I really didn't think you needed any money to run a business, and you don't need oodles and oodles. That's the big thing that I need to really focus on here. Some people go over financing, they go and get £1 million when they need 20,000. And some people get no money when they need 5,000. To run a successful business, you need a good website. You need facilities to work in, and you need to make sure your product is polished so you're delivering your customers a good finished product and service. And if you cut corners, your business shuts down. So by having the right amount of financing, you can get staff, you can get facilities, you can get a website and go to market in the right way. And a lot of people, the reason they just fizzle out is they try and string it along to start with no finance and build their business up over time. But that period takes so long that they're just out of the market in 5 years because people have advanced too far.
Right, great advice. And lastly, number seven.
Number seven is, this is the most important tip if you don't listen to any of my tips. Tip number seven is focus and hard work. The key to running any business successful is your personal focus as a business person and working hard. You can have any idea, you can have as much money, the best business plan, all the best mentors and advisors and read every book under the sun, but if you're not committed to your business and going to work hard, you're not going to be successful.
Okay.
There's so many hard days in business, and there's a lot of days and nights I've had where I've gone home and not thought I could go in tomorrow because of the stress and the heartache.
Yeah.
Because running a business in the first year is incredibly hard. Over 50,000 businesses were started last month in the UK. Mm. That's a lot of competition. That's a lot of new people coming in.
Yeah.
It's a lot of stress, but you've just got to continue to go in the next day and the next day, and eventually you keep learning, you keep grinding, and you get to a point where I walk into my offices and I see all the people and I can't believe I've built it.
Oh, that's amazing, Mark. Thank you so much.
Anytime.
And I'm so glad to say that we are going to be seeing you again next month, right?
I'm here all
soon,
the time. I'm looking forward to it.
Because we've got quite a few episodes lined up with you and you're going to be giving great advice as usual, but it's amazing today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chrissy. Thanks for having me on again.
It's lovely to have you. Now, we all know exercise is essential for our well-being, but having a business to run can leave you with little time to look after yourself. Well, never fear, as here we have our fitness expert, Ben Cooper, showing us how we can fit exercise into a busy routine.
Hi, I'm Ben. Welcome to the Move 360 Studios. We're here for the Chrissy B Show. I'm going to give you some general fitness tips on how to keep yourselves healthy with just integrating into your life slowly. So what you need to think about is things that you do every day automatically. So you might get up and out of a chair, which is a squat. You might step into the car, which is a lunge. All of these things we do every single day, but we're not aware that we're doing them. So those can then become your fitness routine. So you can start to do squats, you can start to do lunges, and that again will start to build muscle. You'll start to lose weight. There's other things we need to consider when trying to lose weight, and one of them is sleep. So when you're exercising, you're breaking down muscle tissue, then you need to repair that during the night to make sure that you're building muscle tissue back again, because you can't just exercise and expect results. So making sure you're doing those big exercises like squats and lunges, and make sure you're getting enough sleep at night from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. and then you'll be seeing really, really good results. We just need a couple of dumbbells. If you haven't got dumbbells, just use some books, some cans, anything you've got at home. Just hold them in front of you. We're gonna squat down and come up. Squat down and come up. Holding the dumbbells this way keeps your back nice and upright, and you get to work your biceps and your upper back at the same time as you're squatting. And you want to do about 10 to 12 reps of those squats. Then with your same dumbbells, we're going to go into a shoulder width stance, bend of the hips, nice straight back, and then pull through with the arms. So like a scarecrow, just a few teaching points, just let the arms hang down and then you're pulling back from the elbows. If you don't have weights, you can just hold yourself like this with the arms out and hold for about a minute. That'll be quite tough because that'll really work the extensors in the back. Okay, and now we're gonna go on to our push-ups, which are down onto the mat. So you're just gonna use your body weight. A few teaching points on how to do a proper push-up. Make sure your chin stays in. So watch me when you do it, and then I'll explain it again. So down, chin comes in. So a lot of people try and get their head down to the ground, which pulls you into very bad posture. So the chin comes forward. Make sure it's the chest that's going to the floor. And the elbows can stay about 45 degrees from the shoulder and pushing up from there. So watch me again on that. Okay, and then you should have a really good push-up that works your abs, your chest, your arms, pretty much your whole body along with the rest of the exercise. If you struggle to do a full push-up, you can do a slightly easier version, which you stay on your knees, so cross your feet at the back, but make sure, again, the same principles. The chin stays in, chest to the floor, and back up. Okay, you don't want to do it like this. That's not a push-up. We're gonna go here, hips come forward, chest comes down, chin stays in. Push. That way we still work the abdominals, otherwise they just get left behind and no one wants to leave their abdominals behind. So talking of abs, we're going to go on to a more specific abdominal exercise. I call this navel radiation. The belly button is the navel, so we're going to radiate around it to work the abdominal wall. So lying down on your mat, spread out like a starfish, and then you're going to come up to the middle and then control back up. Okay, and open the arms and legs back where they were. Come up again. And control down. So when you're doing that one, try and keep your tongue to the roof of your mouth. That helps to use the right muscles in your neck. And try and breathe out as you come up and breathe in as you go back. And you'll really feel that start to work those abdominal muscles. And it's a great complement after the muscles we've already worked, so the whole body has got to work out in those four exercises.
Thank you very much to Ben Cooper. Well, after the break, Dr. Rob Hicks will be answering all of your medical questions in Doctor's Answer, so don't go away. Welcome back to the programme, everyone, where today we've been getting some fantastic advice from our new resident business expert, Mark Wright. But now it's time for our weekly Doctor's Answers with our very own Dr. Rob Hicks. And if you have any questions that you would like to ask Rob, please do email us on info@chrissybshow.tv. Welcome to the show, Rob.
Hi, Chris. Hi.
It's lovely to have you on.
It's good. I need to read more books.
Yes, me too.
I think.
Definitely.
There's a good reason.
Yeah. Okay. So, Rob, we have a few questions today and also some video questions. So let's start with the first one. This person says, hello, I am a 76-year-old male and used to use Viagra to help me gain erections, but this no longer seems to work. I sometimes have night erections, but sexual arousal can be difficult. Do you have any advice?
Yes, lots of good advice, I hope. Yes. That was a bit presumptuous of me, wasn't it? But look, I used to run a men's health clinic, so this is an area that I know a little bit about. Mm-hmm. One of the things to think about is whether this is actually a problem with the medication. So there are times when the medication, you need a different dose or a different formulation, or whether this is actually low libido, so low sex drive. Because one of the things with Viagra and the other treatments that are similar to it is you have to be in the mood for them to work. So is this, you know, maybe because actually you're feeling tired? Is it because you've got an underactive thyroid? Could you have depression? Have you got a lot of increase in stress in your life? You know, have you been perhaps drinking too much alcohol? You know, all those things can sap libido. So those are things to think about and also to have a chat with your doctor about. Are you on another different medication, maybe for high blood pressure? Because one of the side effects of many different medications is it can hit a man's libido and indeed cause erectile dysfunction. So it might be that you need a change of that medicine, and then all the erection problems will disappear and you'll be able to enjoy a satisfactory sex life. The other thing is whether you do actually, you know, there are other treatments for erectile dysfunction, and it might be then that you need to try something different. But I think the key thing is you've asked me the question, I can ask you lots of questions, so have a checkup with your doctor, because the bottom line is if you want to have a satisfactory sex life, age is no barrier to that in this day and age.
Thanks, Rob. Let's take a look at the next question now.
My question for the doctor is, I've been struggling for a long time with anxiety, depression, insomnia, social anxiety, social phobias, and some other things that I said before, like I've got habits, overeating, staying up late, and I'm just trying to figure out what the next steps. I'm looking into therapy, getting therapy like group therapy, and I don't want to take drugs like citalopram and other drugs. What else can I do? Am I just being lazy, or are there other things?
Interesting question, Rob.
Lots of issues there, actually. Yeah. Lots of different mental health problems mm-hmm. there. You know, the first thing that I would want to know is what treatments has he had so far? Mm-hmm. What types of counselling has he had so far? Has he had one-to-one counselling? Because with those different problems, there are different forms of counselling. Okay. So, you know, with phobias, you'd have, may have a different form of counselling to depression and anxiety. So those are the sort of questions before we move forward. Mm-hmm. The next thing is that there's a very clear steer there about I don't want to take medication.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah. And some people think that it's a sign of weakness if they take medication, and I would say that's not the case. Mm-hmm. You know, it's actually a sign of strength for, to ask for help and to go to counselling and to take medication when it's recommended. Mm-hmm. And what I say to my patients is that medication essentially is like antidepressants for somebody who's depressed. Actually will put you in a frame of mind and in a position where you can get the best out of counselling. Because often it's a, quite a struggle to go through counselling if you're still feeling very, very low. And I used to use an analogy that all, let's say that all you have to do in the day is walk across a flat field. It's simple enough.
Yeah.
But if you're stuck in a hole in that field and there's no ladder, there's no rope, there's no steps, then walking across that field it's very difficult. Yeah. So antidepressants help move you to a position where you can actually tackle crossing the field. Okay. The other thing to think about is you know, there's a lot of stress mentioned there. So what are the techniques that he might use to relieve that stress? Mm-hmm. And also, if sleeping is a problem and overeating is a problem, there are different ways of tackling that. So we've got a doctor's orders information video on insomnia. We've got one on managing stress. So there's a good place.
Which you can find on our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show.
So it's a good place to have a look. But the most important thing, I think, is with mental health problems, you can't tackle them alone. Mm-hmm. And the first thing that I think he should do is actually sit down with his doctor and talk through what the issues are, what's already been tried, and then formulate a plan of action.
And also to get to the root of the issues as well, because, you know, it could be something that he's been through in the past that he hasn't dealt with, and that's bringing up all these other issues and, you know.
But there's a lot of problems, there's a lot of challenges there.
Yeah, there are.
You know, with the phobias and the anxiety and everything else that he was describing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's not going to be a quick solution.
No. But it is
eminently possible to overcome these things, as we all know.
Yes, it is. Okay, so thanks for that question. Next one, this person says, every night I feel nauseous for about an hour before I go to bed. It seems like it gets worse when I get my period, but I'm not sure if they're connected. Why is this happening, and is it serious?
Well, I mean, whether this is serious or not actually will depend on how it's affecting you, and indeed whether you've got other symptoms. So are you losing weight, for example, without realising it? You know, are you getting pains as well as the nausea? Have the pattern of your bowel openings changed? That sort of thing. The first thing that springs to mind for me actually is this needs to be checked out by your doctor. So do go along and have a checkup. What's coming into my mind is this actually, when you describe nausea, could this be related to indigestion and heartburn? The fact that it happens, you know, just before you go to bed, you know, is it related to something you've been eating? Is it related to something you've been drinking that's actually upsetting your stomach? The other thing is what we find, people who have got anxiety and stress and are worried about something, nausea is a very, very common symptom. And there is a time before we go to bed when we start to unwind and we relax, and things that perhaps we've kept at the back of our mind during the day because we've been busy doing other things are able to come to the forefront. So is this actually related to an emotional problem rather than the physical one?
Okay,
is it related to a medication that you're taking? Could it be a side effect? So there are a number of different, you know, angles and avenues to pursue with your symptom, but I think what's most important is you get checked out.
Brilliant. Okay, next question, Rob. I've got a bit more time. So my father was diagnosed with dementia about 6 years ago, but the main issue at the moment is his constant loss of balance and falling over, which is now more or less on a daily basis. Could this be something else and not the original diagnosis?
Well, the answer is it could be related to the dementia.
Okay.
In the dizziness and falls, you know, occur with people who've got dementia. Mm-hmm. And it depends on the severity of the dementia at this stage.
Okay.
Yeah. The other thing is it could be purely coincidental.
Mm.
So the sorts of things that cause falls in older people Often it can be a side of, you know, low blood pressure. So people stand up, they feel dizzy, and they fall down again. And that can sometimes be because actually they're receiving, let's say, a treatment for high blood pressure, and it's working too well, so it's keeping the blood pressure too low. And they don't necessarily have to be standing up for that to happen. They can just move around, but they get lightheaded and over they go. The other thing that can cause this is visual problems, and hearing problems are common causes of falls. Muscle weakness is another, and you know, drinking too much alcohol can obviously, you know, impair somebody's balance and make them fall over. So the key thing I would recommend that there are three checks that are made. One is a medical checkup with a doctor. The other is an eye test to see whether vision is actually what the problem is. Or not seeing clearly, and a hearing test to see whether actually that's contributing to the problem. Then the other thing that I would take steps in the meantime to do immediately is to make the area, the home, safe. So no loose rugs, no trailing cables, make sure that the home is well lit. You know, because it's often simple things like that are responsible for anybody, particularly older people, to suffer falls, because what you don't want is a fall ending up with a fracture or a head injury and going into hospital.
Okay, thanks for that question. And now let's go back to the streets to get the next question.
I would like to know what I could do to release my back pain due to stress, sitting down in the office for hours, 9 to 5. You end up having a terrible back pain if you do that constantly as a job. So I would like to know what you could do to release that pain, back pain.
You know what I love about that question? Really common problem. And actually, she's told us the answer. Sat down in front of a computer, 9 to 5, stressed. Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's relatively easy for me to answer that. And the simple things with this whole problem is posture. And the moment I say it, yeah, we'll both sit up.
Yes, we are.
Yes. Regular breaks where you get up and move around. Mm-hmm.
I'll spend half an hour in the garden.
If you could manage that. I told you that confidentially.
Sorry, Rob.
A way of unwinding, yes, and relieving stress, another good idea. Or in whatever way works for you as the individual.
Yes.
Make sure the workstation is set up, mm-hmm, so you're not sort of
hunched over.
And most importantly, if this isn't getting better with those measures. And particularly if there are other symptoms, so any sort of numbness or tingling in the legs, get along to the doctor and get checked out.
Okay.
But this is a very common problem, and usually it's very easy to solve it.
Okay, brilliant. Rob, we've got time for one. We've got to whiz through this one.
Okay, I'll whiz through
this one. So I have little white bumps on the rim of one of my eyelids. They're not painful in any way, but I think I have been getting more recently. What could they be and how can I get rid of them?
Okay, very, very quick answer. Obviously, these need to be seen. So, you know, pop along to your doctor or indeed your optometrist and the eye specialist, and they will have a look. But what it sounds like to me is something called milia, which essentially is nothing to worry about. It's where the parts of the skin get blocked and a protein called keratin, which is something which helps keep the structure of our skin in good shape, basically builds up because it can't escape. More often than not, it takes a few weeks and these things will disappear naturally. Most importantly, do not pick them. Uh-huh. If they're still there after a few weeks or causing you problems, have a chat with your doctor, because there are ways of getting rid of them. But generally speaking, they will go all by themselves.
Brilliant. Rob, thank you so much for answering the viewer
questions pleasure.
For
Always
us.
My pleasure.
And we'll see you again next week.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, everybody, we have reached the end of today's programme, but if you have anything that you would like to share with us, maybe it's a question for our doctor here, maybe it's you have an inspiring story you'd like to share, please do get in touch with us via the website, chrissybshow.tv. You can also tweet us at Chrissy B Show or leave a message on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Until next time, bye-bye for now. Now, that last topic is a big one, and you don't get much more success. Really? And the internet is estimated to represent a £19 billion business opportunity. Welcome back to the Chrissy B Show, everyone. Well, sorry.